Right. We're doing this big, the Bible's big picture of the story. At least that's how I see it, as the Bible's big picture. It's an overview. I was talking to Meg this morning. I didn't know how helpful it'll be, because I don't know how many people can actually be here for the get the whole kind of flow. It just seems in the summer people are out a lot. But anyway, we're pitching it, and I hope it's doing something. So I'm going to go back and get some of Daniel. And I hope if I repeat what he said, some of it, then just bear with me. But in talking about Ezra, I need to set the stage for the return. And of course, Ezra's a bit after that, but I wanted to talk about that. Now, Daniel, as you know, was taken into Babylonian captivity around 605 BC. There were really three exiles. Nebuchadnezzar comes, and this is before he's crowned, this is when he's crowned prince, before he's king. But in 605, or some of his delegates, they take people captive. That's Daniel. And then 598, 597, you have another very large and significant exile, and that's when Ezekiel goes into captivity. And then in 587, 586, and you have that because there's always some kind of disagreement about the exact date, whether it's 87, 86. Some people say, no, it's definitely this, and you read somebody else say, no, it's not quite that definite. So I give it as the 87/86. But that's when Nebuchadnezzar comes after another rebellion, and he destroys the city of Jerusalem, including the temple. Now, Daniel, he's in exile, and he notes in the beginning of Daniel chapter 9 that in the first year of the reign of Darius the Mede. Now, I don't know how Anthony understood that, but I take Darius the Mede to just be an alternate way of referring to Cyrus the Great. Okay, now when I taught the book of Daniel, I explained that. I'm not going to explain that now. Just understand that's who I take Darius the Mede to be, just an alternate way of referring to Cyrus the Great. But in the first year of the reign of Darius the Mede, Daniel understood, he says, in the scrolls. Now by that he means in the scrolls recognized as inspired by God. He doesn't just mean any scroll, he means the scrolls. So Daniel understood in the scrolls that God had revealed to the prophet Jeremiah, who stayed in Palestine, but that God had revealed to the prophet Jeremiah that it would take 70 years for the fulfilling of the devastations of Jerusalem. In other words, the Jewish exile from the city would last that long. So Daniel's in captivity, and in the first year of Cyrus the Great, Darius the Mede, he's reading and he understands from the scrolls that Jeremiah had said that the captivity would last 70 years. But that's not as clear as you would think, because it's not clear when the clock began. There were three exiles, 605, 598, 597, 587, 586. And it's also not clear whether 70 was symbolic. You see, whether it represented the full time determined by God, it being a multiple of 7 and 10, two numbers that symbolize completeness. So there was this uncertainty. When does the clock begin to run, and is this a literal chronological 70 years, or is it some kind of symbolic for the completeness? So it's not completely clear. And the first year of Darius's reign, Darius the Mede, it refers to his first year as full year as ruler of the defeated Babylonians, which would have been in March 538 B.C., So this is when Daniel is there. Daniel in March 538 B.C., and that was not long after Daniel's deliverance from the lion's den in Daniel chapter 6. And Daniel's now been in Babylonia for 67 or 68 years, roughly, right around there. He's going to be 80 years old, maybe a little bit older. So he spent basically all his life in Babylonia. And the passages in Jeremiah to which Daniel refers are Jeremiah 25, 11 and 12, and Jeremiah 29, 10. Now, both of those texts indicate that at the end of the 70 years, that the end would be marked by God's punishment of Babylonia. So somehow that's connected. You see, whatever this 70 is, when it begins to run, it's going to be tied with God's punishment of Babylonia. And in light of the Babylonians' recent fall to the Medes and Persians in 539, when Cyrus came and went, so we're now in 538, in Cyrus's first full year of reigning. So he sees that now the Babylonians have in fact fallen, he perceived that the time for the restoration, the time for the running of the 70 years was at hand. And that's what motivates this prayer that he prays in Daniel chapter 9. That's what's motivating that prayer. And in chapter 9, verses 3 to 19, Daniel recounts how he, with fasting and with sackcloth and ashes, all of those are emblems of repentance. Okay, so he recalls how he, with fasting and in sackcloth and ashes, poured out his heart to God on behalf of Israel. It's this powerful, penitent plea for God now to fulfill his promise to end the punishment by restoring his people to Jerusalem. So that's what Daniel's doing. Daniel prays now, seeing the fall of the Babylonians, he's praying, now, you know, end this captivity and bring your people home. We've been suffering here. And Daniel seems to have in mind in that prayer in Daniel chapter 9, he seems to have in mind Solomon's prayer at the dedication of the newly built temple, especially the portion of that prayer that's recorded in 1 Kings chapter 8, 46 through 51, where Solomon had prayed over 400 years earlier. Over 400 years earlier, he said, if they sin against you, for there's no one who does not sin. See, they knew that in the Old Testament. You see, I mean, they understood that. All right, he says, and you are angry with them and give them to an enemy so that they're carried away captive to the land of the enemy, far off or near. Yet if they turn their heart to the land to which they have been carried, in the land to which they've been carried captive, and repent and plead with you in the land of their captors, saying, we have sinned and have acted perversely and wickedly. Well, Daniel tracks that language in his prayer. He tracks that very language. And he says in verse 48, if they repent and all with all their mind and with all their heart in the land of their enemies who carried them captive and pray to you toward their land, which you gave to the fathers, the city that you've chosen and the house that I built for your name, then hear in heaven your dwelling place their prayer and their plea and maintain their cause and forgive your people who sinned against you and all their transgressions that they've committed against you and grant them compassion in the sight of those who carried them captive that they may have compassion on them, for they are your people and your heritage which you brought out of Egypt from the midst of the iron. Let them come home. You see, so he's praying that in Daniel chapter 9. He prays that prayer, and like I said, he tracks the language in 9:5 that we've sinned and done wrong and we've acted wickedly. So he seems to have this prayer in mind of what God had said. And as they are truly penitent people, Daniel's point is God need not delay his promised extension of mercy to them. Now's the time. Bring us home. And so Daniel prays that prayer, and verses 16 to 19 of Daniel chapter 9 are an appeal to God's mercy that he not delay in delivering them from captivity, that he again look with favor on Jerusalem and on his destroyed sanctuary. So all of that is what Daniel is praying. He wants God to move the people to allow them to come home, to extend his mercy, as Solomon had said, when we do this. And so he wants them to do that. And what do you know? Not long after that, don't know exactly how long, but soon, whether it's months, I don't know, but Cyrus issues the decree that is given in Ezra in chapter 1. He issues that decree, and also in 2 Chronicles 36, 22, and 23, the very last words of the book of Chronicles, 2 Chronicles, Cyrus issues this decree where he allows the people, the Jews, to return to their homeland. Now, you have to think about that. You think about how impossible that looked, that you are this nobody carried captive for repeated rebellions. Nebuchadnezzar takes you there. Everybody hates you. You're basically finished. You're this small Jewish minority. Who do you think is going to believe that you're going to be sent home? Nobody. You know, you're certainly not going to fight your way home. And yet here's Cyrus who allows them to come home. Now this was, of course, considered false by critics. When you read this in Ezra, you read this in 2 Chronicles, they thought, oh no, no, no 6th century B.C. ruler would ever act that way. No 6th century B.C. ruler would ever allow captives. Why would he lose the manpower? Why would he do that? Never happened. That's what they thought until 1879 when Hormuz Rassam, an Iranian archaeologist working with the British Museum, he discovered in the city of Nineveh what's called the Cyrus Cylinder. The Cyrus Cylinder, here's a picture of this little archaeological artifact. It's a clay cylinder that was inscribed at the direction of King Cyrus. So King Cyrus has his people inscribe this cylinder. And it's about 10 inches long, about 5 inches wide. It's written in Akkadian. And Cyrus, he doesn't specifically mention Judah in this cylinder, but he there reports how he returned cult images, idols to the former sanctuaries. He established permanent sanctuaries for them, and he returned the former inhabitants to the lands of their various gods. No 6th century B.C. ruler would act that way. Then we find a cylinder where he says, here was my policy. I sent the people back. I returned them. If we'd taken a god or something from their place, I would go over here and set it up for them. And so we have that, we have there. Cyrus, he credits his god Marduk with selecting him and giving him the task of ruling over the world. But he is, of course, God's instrument. The fact he's not tuned into that, he's still doing God's bidding. He's God's instrument. Who's doing? He's like, oh, Marduk. No Marduk. God. Yahweh. And he's the one. You see, and you see that in Isaiah 44, 28 through 45, 6, that he'd been predicted by name to be the one who would be raised up. You see? Predicted by name that Cyrus, God would use Cyrus to rescue the Jewish people. So we have that, and I always like that. Like I said, there's some artifacts I can't pass up. That's one of them. But if you're interested in this, by the way, if you go to my website, which is theoutlet.us, there's a paper there called Archaeology in the Bible, and has many things in it described and laid out. It doesn't have the slides, which I did when I was teaching it, but maybe someday, Lord willing, I'll teach that again. All right. It took the Jews some time. When Cyrus comes and says, okay, you can go home. Well, they've been in Babylonian captivity for 70 years. You see, people have died, have been born, raised there. This is their home. So it's going to take some time for people to plan such a significant uprooting and dislocation. This is where you live. What are you going to do? Well, we're going to uproot, and we're going to go to Jerusalem, a city that's in ruins. And we're going to start a life there. That's going to require some planning. Okay, so I don't know how long it would take them to get their affairs in order, and then it would also, and make the preparations, you see, for the relocation, but it would also take them some time to complete the roughly 900-mile journey from Babylon to Jerusalem. Now, that would be something, and I assume they picked a certain time of year. It's like Brother John traveling to China. He wants to go when the weather's right, you see. You know, he don't want to go there during rainy season or during some other cold thing. He's going to go there when it's right. But, of course, you never have control over the weather. So if it's overcast, Harry's going to have to shoot him, I think. So, but and also after so many decades, it shouldn't surprise you that that some of the Jews, they chose to stay where they were and to live as a minority group of foreigners in a Mesopotamia under Persian rule. You know, I mean, it was quite a risk. I mean, traveling there and all that, and, you know, you're pretty much settled in your life. So there are Jews who remain there. But you have this this exodus that comes out, a kind of exodus where you have people come out. The first 6 chapters of the book of Ezra, they deal almost exclusively with the return from exile and the building of the temple. The first 6 chapters of Ezra, it's basically a continuation of Chronicles. The Chronicles leaves off with the decree. The first 6 chapters of Ezra are basically a continuation of that deal with the return from exile after Cyrus's decree and the building of the temple. Now, I say almost exclusively because chapter 4, verse 6 through verse 23, seems to be out of chronological order. It seems to relate to a later opposition. And I think it was put there because he's talking about opposition, so it's put there because of the topic, and it deals with opposition. But mainly, those first six chapters are with the exile and the building of the temple. Now, the first group of Jewish exiles, here's a little chart, yeah. The first group of Jewish exiles, they returned to Jerusalem under the leadership of Sheshbazzar, Zerubbabel, and Joshua. And his name is sometimes spelled Jeshua, but same person, the high priest. So they lead this group back, these exiles back, and they promptly set up the altar in its former place, and they resume the offering of sacrifices amid the ruins. So here they are, the temple is in ruins, but they set up the altar, and they begin offering the sacrifices there. This is right when they come back. Now in 536, now when did they get back? Well, he's praying in 538. Don't know how long after that the decree is issued. Don't know how much time it would take them. Don't know when they chose him. So, 536 maybe, 537 maybe. You still can't be sure. But we know they're building the temple. They lay the foundation of the temple, of the new temple, in 536. They first built the altar. They're making sacrifices amid the ruins. 536, they lay the foundations of the temple. And one of the interesting things, at least to me, is that when they lay the foundations, there's much celebration. People are happy, but there's also the old people who remember the former temple are wailing. They're crying because it compared so unfavorably with the great temple that Solomon had built. So here they are, they're back, and they're going to lay the foundation for this temple. Hey, there's some people going, man, this is a killer, you see. Well, that, you see, how that temple compared so unfavorably to the one with Solomon, the fact they were still ruled by foreigners, and the fact of ongoing sin, as you will see. See, these were signals that the return from captivity, that this was not God's ultimate restoration. It wasn't God's ultimate restoration. That was yet future. You see, it's a tremendous thing. It is an amazing second kind of exodus to take this little group of captives. What's going to happen? Watch this. You come on over here, right back to Jerusalem. I mean, that's an amazing thing. But you see these indications that it's not the ultimate restoration. You see, all of these images that have been painted by the prophets of the great glory that was going to characterize God's ultimate restoration, they come back, here it is, this is it. They come back, and the temple, they're going, that doesn't really look like the great glorious temple I'm thinking of. And, well, we're still under foreign rule. That doesn't seem quite. And what? We're still tormented by sin. Okay, so these are threads, you see, that point to the fact that return was not God's ultimate restoration. Well, opposition from the local residents and the neighboring communities, especially the Samaritans, caused the work to grind to a halt. They laid the foundation. They built the altar. They were offering sacrifices amid the ruins. They lay the foundation. Some of the old people who remembered the other altar, they were really distressed by it, but there was celebration. The two are mixed. But then you have the work on building the temple grinds to a halt. Why? Because people are bothering them, pestering them, after them. See, they're opposing what they're doing. Now, the Samaritans, they were the descendants. You remember Israel's taken, destroyed ultimately in 722, 721, when the Assyrians come in and they destroy the city of Samaria, the capital. That's the end of the northern kingdom of Israel. The Assyrians imported into the northern kingdom all kinds of foreign people. And those Israelites who were left, who had not been carted off, They then intermarried, and the Samaritans are the descendants of those people. So what you have, this is why the Jews looked at them, see, they were kind of syncretistic. They fused different religions. It wasn't simply that they were impure in their lineage, that they'd mixed with pagans. It's that they also have these other elements and influences coming in. But the Samaritans are the descendants of those people. And you see the hostility here, that they are opposing them. They come down and they first say, hey, listen, how about we help you in this rebuilding effort? And the Jews go, no dice. Now, why did they do that? Because they understood that they weren't really sincere about helping them, because if the Jews rise to prominence and become another, you know, a powerful state, the Samaritans' influence is diminished. So they didn't trust them. They thought they're going to be a Trojan horse. They're going to be inside working with us. They're going to work against us. So they said, let us help you. They said, no thanks. And so the Samaritans then took that refusal and rejection to intensify their opposition to the Jews. And so the hostility that you see between Jews and Samaritans, referred to in the New Testament, is of long standing. You see, we're back here in the 6th century. Long time. And we've had other things, by the way, that have gone on closer to the New Testament. But you see, there's a lot of hostility here. And that's what gives some of the Lord's teaching so much punch, when he will use a Samaritan in some of his teaching. You see, so that you say, you see, well, who helped the man? Well, a Samaritan helped him. Not a Samaritan. You know, give me anybody but a Samaritan. No, no, no. Who was the neighbor to the man? I guess the one who helped him. I guess. All right, you got it. You go new likewise. All right, so he uses that, but that's where it's from. Now, according to Ezra 4:4-5, he says, then the peoples around them set out to discourage the people of Judah and make them afraid to go on building. They hired counselors to work against them. They're bureaucrats. That's right. They got people who are going to go, and they're going to cause you problems with the ruling powers. But he says, they hired counselors to work against them and frustrate their plans during the entire reign of Cyrus, king of Persia, and down to the reign of Darius, king of Persia. Now, this isn't Darius the Mede. The Darius referred to here is he ruled from 522 to 486. 522 to 486. Okay, so we have Cyrus the Great, Darius the Mede, and then we have this king Darius, king of Persia, who reigns after that in 522 to 486. Now, the temple is still in ruins. It's still in ruins 16 years later. Okay, they come back, get there, you know, 537, 536. Great start, lay the foundation. Opposition causes them not to keep building the temple, and the temple's not built 16 years later. You see, it's still, the temple is still in ruins. And this is when you have the prophets Haggai and Zechariah. Those prophets, that's where they come. And they are prophesying to the people, and they inspired, and they motivated, and they encouraged the people to resume the work on the temple. So here they were after 16 years of the temple just sitting there. And you got these prophets who come, God speaks to the people through these prophets and gets them to resume the work. You remember Haggai, this great line of Haggai. Haggai chapter 1 verse 4, he says, is it time for you yourselves to dwell in your paneled houses while this house lies in ruins? Yeah, the prophet's encouraging them, all right. He's telling them, listen, oh, we don't have time, we don't have the money, we can't do it. And he comes and says, well, listen, you're looking pretty good over here on the North Shore. You know, up here on the North Slope or wherever it is that you got your paneled house. It's time for you to get on with rebuilding the temple. And so they resume, but when they resume this, Tattenai, who's the governor of the Persian province, he writes to Darius. He says, well, you know, this has been a good while. You know, he's now the governor there. He's looking around going, can they do this? I see them building this thing. Is this going to be a good thing? Is it okay with you that they're doing this? So really what he wants is him to say, no, stop it. But he writes to Darius to find out if it's acceptable. And this is when Darius goes and roots around and he finds Cyrus's original decree. And he tells Tatanai not only to let the building project proceed, but also fund it from the royal revenue. Now, who's doing this? Does the writer have to tell you, by the way, this is God? You see, it's just all over. You see it. He doesn't have to say it. He said, well, how can this little group of people get sent back? All this opposition, these people jumping on them. They go over here back to, Tatanai sends back to the king. And the king says, oh, no, that's good. They're good. By the way, go ahead and pay for it. Okay. So God is at work, and you see God behind this enterprise. So despite this ongoing opposition, the temple is then completed in typically the age given, year given is 516. Some would say 515. But the temple is completed, and the temple personnel, they were reappointed and reestablished. And there was this joyful celebration that you see in Ezra chapter 6, verses 14 to 18. And then the Passover was celebrated at the end of Ezra chapter 6. So here we have a restoration. We finally have the temple built. Good things are going. And then the second half of the book, we now get Ezra's return. See, all of this in the first six chapters of Ezra, this is really the continuation of Chronicles of what happened after Cyrus said, you can go home. They go home, they face opposition, build the altar, offer the sacrifices, lay the foundation, stall out because of opposition, get preached to, finally resume, and they ultimately build the temple. In 516, 515. Well, Ezra comes back. Ezra, the second part, recounts Ezra's return to Jerusalem and his ministry there. Ezra leads a group back now in 458. Okay, you keep some of these years in mind, right? 539, Cyrus conquers the Babylonians. 538, issues a decree. They come back. Say 536, they lay the foundation of the temple, complete the temple, 516, 515. This is 458. Okay, this is 458 B.C., some 58 years after the dedication of the rebuilt temple. Now, do you see how God moves? You and I, what's he doing? Why is he doing that? But look at captivity. Look at captivity. Look at slavery in Egypt. Look at everything. God, he moves in his time. You see, he moves in his time. We'd just be going, 58 years. What in the world? 58 years, that's what it was. But Ezra returns. And this is during the reign of the Persian king. Now the Persian king is Artaxerxes I. That's who the king is when Ezra returns. He reigns from 464 to 423. And we know almost nothing about the life of the Jewish people in Palestine from the dedication of the temple in 516, 515 until Ezra's return in 458. But some things we can infer from what Ezra says. But we don't really have records and things about what's going on during that interim. Well, Ezra is a priest. He's a descendant of Aaron, who was an expert in the law of Moses. And you could see how that could get lost, couldn't you? What do we care? The temple's destroyed. We're all through. But that wasn't how Ezra was. Ezra devoted himself to studying. And I got to say, sometimes we look down on the ministry of study, and I think it's crazy. Okay? I just think it's crazy. We are so skeptical of these kinds of things, sometimes. And I think, look, I've told people before, I said, you know, the Bibles we read are the product of scholars. I don't care about scholars, I only care about the Bible. The Bible you read is the product of scholars. The encyclopedias you go to learn about things, all the labor of scholars. So don't just sweep them in the trash can, okay? You have to be wise in how you use things, okay? That's true of everything in life, all right? You have to be wise in how you do it. But here's Ezra, who devotes himself to studying the law, and he devotes himself and becomes, he's an expert in it. It says in Ezra 7:10, for Ezra had set his heart to study the law of the Lord and to do it and to teach his statutes and rules in Israel. So here we have Ezra. He sought to know, to live, and to teach the will of God as revealed in Scripture. You see, he took the Word of God with the gravity and the seriousness that it deserves. I say, this is no ordinary book. This is the Word of God. This is the holy Word of God. Holy Scriptures. And so he understood that, and he's reading the scrolls and giving them their due. And because the hand of the Lord was on the king, Artaxerxes, he sent Ezra on his way with his blessings and with considerable financial support. And Ezra's bringing a group. So we had the initial return, and now in 458, here comes Ezra and some other people, and Ezra's coming here. He's an expert in the law, and he's going to come here, and he's going to instruct the people. He's going to make sure that the people stay on track. Ezra 7, 27 and 28 says, "Blessed be the Lord, the God of our fathers, who put such a thing as this into the heart of the king." He goes to the king, and the king said, "You know, I've told you before, ancient kings, you know, this wasn't a democracy. Ancient king kill you and nobody bat an eye." Right? Nobody bat an eye. You know the story of Esther? Look, if I go to see him and I haven't worked it out and don't have an appointment, you don't just come into the king's presence. It's an insult. Who do you think you are coming into the king's presence? If he doesn't hold out that scepter when I show up unannounced, I'm dead. I don't care who you are. And nobody batted an eye. But here he goes to the king, and the king says, "What? Sure, man, go." And Ezra knows who's at work. He sits here and says, "Blessed be the Lord, the God of our fathers, who put such a thing into the heart of the king to beautify the house of the Lord that is in Jerusalem, and who extended to me his steadfast love before the king and his counselors and for all the king's mighty officers. I took courage, for the hand of the Lord my God was on me, and I gathered leading men from Israel to go up with me." And so here he is, he goes there, and God grants him favor with the king. Now recall that it was during the reign of Artaxerxes' predecessor. Okay, this is during the reign of Artaxerxes. Artaxerxes' predecessor, the prior Persian king, was Ahasuerus, whose better known Greek name is Xerxes. In Hebrew, it comes to as Ahasuerus, same guy. But his predecessor was Ahasuerus. And it was during the reign of Ahasuerus that Esther and Mordecai had prominent positions. So in God's, see, this is how God works. You try to figure out God, and it'll blow your mind. You see, so is God's putting his hand on this king Artaxerxes? Well, how did he do that? Well, you're not told. You just know that he moved him. Well, could he have moved him in part by saying, "Listen, oh, you remember that this favorable sense, this favorable disposition we have toward the Jewish people because of Esther and the prominence of Mordecai in my predecessor's reign? Oh, they're good people. Good for the kingdom." Okay. He does something like that. Now, he may have also used the historical situation to favorably incline the king to Ezra's request. Just a year or two earlier, Egypt, assisted by the Athenians, had rebelled against the Persians, and Judah was an important buffer state. Okay, you got the map in your head, Egypt down here, Mesopotamia over here, like this. Okay, you see? And so Judah is an important buffer state there, and so you can see Artaxerxes, he would want a strong Jerusalem that was really committed to him. All right, well, could that have factored in how God had his hand on it? I think it could. You see, but in any event, he goes and says, "Here's what I want to go there." Oh, yeah, you go. So here we have another exiles returning. Another group of exiles returning. But Ezra's group, they fasted and they beseeched God for a safe journey for themselves, for their children, for their possessions. You see this in 8:22 and 23. Then he says, I always get a kick out of this. He's here praying and all this, beseeching God. And he says, "For I was ashamed to ask the king for a band of soldiers and horsemen to protect us against the enemy on our way, since we told the king The hand of our God is for good on all who seek Him, and the power of His wrath is against all who forsake Him. So we fasted and implored our God for this, and He listened to our entreaty. You see, he didn't want to have to go to the king and say, can you give me some soldiers for the trip? He was afraid the king would say, I thought you had God to protect you. You see, now, this is complicated business, you see, because God works through these kinds of things. When God gives the Israelites land, he doesn't just kill everybody there and say, walk in. He has them go fight. Okay, so in other words, it's not simply theologically cut and dry that you would not want soldiers. But you don't want to start getting into some of those kinds of conversations with skeptics, where you start doing finer slicing theologically and they start going, pfft. Okay? He didn't want to do that. He just comes in and says, no, I didn't want to go. And we're going to trust God and we're praying to God. And what did God do? He brought them in. God brought them in. And I always got a kick out of that that line there. All right, Ezra, he soon learned that he comes back and he soon learns that many of the returned exiles, including the leaders, including Levites and all these people who'd been there for decades, he learns that many of them had sinned by marrying foreign women from foreign communities within the land of Israel. Okay, he finds out that they had sinned by doing this. Now, this was prohibited in principle in Deuteronomy chapter 7, verses 1 to 4, where he prohibited the Israelites from marrying foreigners from indigenous communities within the land of Israel. You see, Esther's going to marry the king. Ruth is a foreigner. So there's some difference, do you see? What God is saying is, you cannot come into the land of Israel and marry a foreign woman from a community that is established within that land. In other words, that there's an established Moabite population there in the land of Israel. You can't marry a foreigner there. Well, why would that be? I think why it is that because the woman who's married from that thing would be more inclined to cling to and even to assert her foreign religion if she had the support of a local community. Whereas if she does not, she's much more inclined to come embrace or at least be neutral. You see, so I think maybe he doesn't spell that out. That's just me thinking. Okay? But I think that's what's going on. But in any event, Ezra comes here and he finds that they had done this. And it's a terrible thing, you see, that has happened. And in chapter 9, Ezra, he led the people in this public prayer of repentance. This public prayer of repentance in Ezra 9. And in chapter 10, they agreed to divorce the foreign wives they had married sinfully. Okay? They agreed to do that. Now, there's all kinds of little things you could talk about that. It seems that though it was sinful, it was still marriage. You see, they're required to be dissolved. But they agreed to do that. And that's something they did. Now, Arnold and Beyer, in their Encountering the Old Testament, they make this comment. It said, these marriages jeopardize the covenant community and the revelation of God Himself. Extreme and drastic measures were required to prevent Yahwism, the worship of Yahweh, from dissolving and blending into the amalgam of religious practices in the Persian period. Over a three-month period, the mixed marriages were systematically dissolved. They had an investigation, you know, who's done what, who's tied up with a foreigner kind of thing. And then you see that in chapter 10 being dissolved. Yet some 25 years later, you see Nehemiah facing the same problem. And this was a persistent problem. And I think part of the reason why it was is that the Persian Empire was very big on syncretism, this idea of merging religions. That was in the air. That was the culture. The notion that all the things are kind of the same and who cares and all the past go to the same place and it doesn't really matter. You see, sounds very much like the culture of our day. You see, there was no one way. No way was considered the way. And that's just all around them. Because remember, they're under Persian rule, even though they're in Palestine. So that's something that's all around them. And that kind of thinking seeps into your mind. You cannot swim in the culture without a very clear awareness of what's going on. You got to be on your toes. You can't just, I'm going to float around. No. You see? And so it seeps in, and it affects how people view things. So the potential, see, of foreign women pulling you from exclusive worship to Yahweh, when you're in that kind of thing and it's affecting your mind, that begins to seem less serious. You see, when you think that there's truth in all ways, it just starts to seem to you not that big a deal. Everybody's, you know, got a piece of truth, so it's just not that big a deal to go ahead and marry. I think that's what's behind the persistence of this problem. And so you wind up having that and doing that. Now, given the trauma of exile that Israel had experienced because of its disobedience to God, something Ezra's seeing repeated, right? He comes back and they've been violating the law of God. They've been marrying these foreign women from these indigenous communities, and he sees that. Well, he emphasizes the law and a determined decision to keep obeying. That's not surprising, is it? Why had they just come back from 70 years of exile? Because they'd rebelled against God and didn't obey him. So Ezra comes back, who's an expert in the law, and he sees that he's telling them the law, the will of God. You have to hold to it. You have to abide by it. He emphasizes that rightly and properly, that they need to obey God if they want to live and prosper in the land. And you see that, and you see this emphasis on the law and this determined keeping of it. You see that in Ezra's later reading of the book of the law of Moses in Nehemiah chapter 8. He wants the people to suck up the word of God. Now you and I got more Bibles down here. I got two sitting here. We got Bibles everywhere. We have to breathe in God's view of things. Hollywood has a view of things. It is not God's view of things. Give me a second here. Let me tell you what I think happens here with Ezra. Okay, Ezra's teaching is good and right and necessary, but what I think happens is it becomes the seed for the distortion that becomes the legalism that you see in the first century. In other words, because of this focus, you see, that was necessary and right and holy, but these things have to be kept in balance. And it is easy when you focus so much on doing the right that you start to slip into the sense that my standing before God is because I do the right. You see? Salvation is and always has been a gift God gives to the faithful. It is never something you purchase by moral performance. You are incapable of doing that. Never. But you see, these things have to be kept in balance. Rather, obedience is part of faith and flows out in gratitude. So it's nothing to sneeze at. It's not something to belittle. It's not something to say, oh, who cares? I have faith. No, they're inextricably connected, but you have to keep the balance right. You always have to understand it is a gift that I express then in my obedience, my gratitude. That's important. This emphasis here, I think, then gets distorted. The Essenes, the Pharisees were particularly vulnerable in that direction. And so when we get to the New Testament, you see these distortions coming up. And I know I'm over time. Thanks.